Welcome, everyone. My name is Maria Elena Perales, and today we are joined by Yesenia Zamirano, Fred Lapusa, Director of the Office of Restorative Justice for the Diocese of Orange, Sisters Kit Gray, Monique Gautier, and Robert Jean Lee. The program is hosted by the Office of Restorative Justice, again from the Diocese of Orange. And today we give a witness to the power of restorative justice and helps us to consider how love changes everything. So I'd like to welcome Sister Kit.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us. And the flow of our session this morning is that we'll have an opening song and prayer, a few short readings, a very brief, powerful video and reflection from Fred Lapusa, opportunity for your own personal reflection, and a closing prayer and song. And so I invite you, as we begin, to center yourself. If that means taking a few deep breaths, being aware of God's presence within you and around you, restorative justice talks about restoring relationships. What does it mean to restore something? And in your experience, what are the effects of broken relationships? Hurt, anger, division, isolation, hostility, resentment, loneliness, sadness, grief, confusion, misunderstanding, abandonment, betrayal, violation. How can these be healed, restored? Why is it important to say, you're sorry, I'm sorry? And why does God want us to forgive one another?
Are all We are blossoming and fading, every color, every sound, every place is holy ground. Oh, every living thing, can you hear it laugh? Can you hear it sing? By breath, by blood, by body, by spirit, we are all one. By breath, by blood, by body, by spirit, we are all one. The fire in my heart, my soul, like the moon, like the Holy One. By breath, by blood, by body, by spirit, we are all one. By breath, by blood, by body, by spirit, we are all.
Lord, on this day, we pray for all who are caught in the web of violence, crime, and incarceration. We pray for all who are held captive, the guilty and the innocent, and those who keep watch over them. May justice and mercy prevail behind the walls of the prison, of the prisons, and in the justice system itself. We pray for the victims of crime, their families, and those who work to support them in the healing of body, mind, and spirit. Nourish and strengthen them so they may live full lives free of hurt, mistrust, and hate. Especially, we ask that you remember, forgive, and restore to a full and free life those who we now name in our hearts. We ask these prayers in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, who sets us free. Amen. When I was in prison, you visited me.
Remember those who are in prison as though you were in prison with them.
Brothers and sisters, even if a person is caught in some transgression, you who are spiritual should correct that one in a gentle spirit.
If anyone has caused pain, he has not caused it to me, but in some measure, not to exaggerate to all of you, this punishment by the majority is enough, such a person, so that on the contrary, you should forgive and encourage him instead, or else the person may be overwhelmed by excessive pain. Therefore, I urge you to reaffirm your love for him.
Let us heal the pain and welcome every person who has committed offenses, who admits their failures, is repentant and truly wants to make reparation, thus contributing to the building of a new order where justice and peace shine forth.
I remember my stepfather, you know, would beat me, and he would beat me with extension cords and hangers and, you know, pieces of wood and all kinds of stuff. And, you know, after every beating, he would tell me, you know, it hurt me more than it hurt you. And, you know, I only did it because I love you. It was kind of, you know, it communicated the wrong message to me about what love was. So for many years, you know, I thought that love was supposed to hurt. And I hurt everyone that I love. And I measured love by how much pain someone would take from me. And it wasn't until I came to prison in an environment that is devoid of love that I began to have some sort of understanding about what it actually was and was not. And I met someone. And she gave me my first real insight into what love was, because she saw past my conditions and the fact that I was in prison with a life sentence for murder. And not only for murder, but for doing the worst kind of murder that a man can do, murdering a woman and a child. And it was Agnes, the mother and grandmother of Patricia and Chris, the woman and child that I murdered, who gave me my best lesson about love, because by all rights, she should hate me. But she didn't. And over the course of time and through the journey that we took, that's been pretty amazing. She gave me love, and she taught me what it was.
Hi, everybody. They said in the introduction, my name is Fred Lapuza with the Office of Restorative Justice with the Catholic Diocese. What a powerful testimony to the transformative power of love the person shared in this video. I don't think anything I can say here today can express the theme of today's presentation better than what we just heard. Love truly does change everything. And I love the title of this presentation today and happy to be able to be part of it. At least that's been my experience working with both incarcerated populations and those who've lost a loved one by homicide. We minister to both of these populations. I think love not only changes us and others, but it changes how we experience God and how we see God in others. In our ministry, I've had the privilege of accompanying both victims and offenders, their families, who have suffered some of the most traumatic experiences imaginable. You heard a little bit of a piece of it, of what happens oftentimes to those of our folks who are incarcerated. The gentleman on the video said that prison is a place void of love. Void of love is void of God. And I think we can all admit that there's many places in our world and in many hearts that are void of love today. We don't have to be behind brick walls and iron bars to be incarcerated. That's a line that I use quite often. Pain and hurt can easily carry inside of us and stay incarcerated inside of us for life. It festers, causes people to act out, often in unhealthy or even criminal ways. So I always say that crime, therefore, becomes a symptom of something that's much deeper and complex. And I remember a quote from Father Richard Rohr once. It said, "Whenever we don't transform our pain, we will always transmit our pain." And there's a phrase we use in restorative justice too that goes, hurt people hurt people. People who have been hurt hurt other people, as we heard by the gentleman in the video, just one example of that. Restorative justice is a concept. It's more than that to me. It's an actual attitude we have to take on, or we try to take on. It's also expressed through practice. It deals with relationships that have been broken by some harm that's been caused. So in our justice system, we don't really look at so much as the law that's been broken as much as we do the relationships that have been broken because of the crime that was committed. It seeks to repair the harm that's caused and heal the relationships. I'd say restorative justice is even countercultural, I think, compared to our human justice system, because it recognizes that we're bound together in some way, where our justice system today, times, and not just our justice system, that spills over into oftentimes our social attitudes. Where we put one person on one side and one person on the other side, and there's just nothing in between. But restorative justice shows that we all belong to one another somehow. I had a former inmate come to my office one day. Been out of prison. He was arrested when he was 17 years old. Now he's in his 40s. He was on a life sentence and he got paroled after his seventh appeal. And he came and he said, I came here today because I want to interview you. He goes, I'm in college now and I'm studying to be a drug and alcohol counselor because I killed somebody, another gang member, when I was in a fight when I was 16 years old. I was high on drugs. I want to make sure that never happens to anybody else again. He goes, but when your volunteers came into the prisons and were doing restorative justice with us, it changed my life. And he says, me and my cellmate walked out of there scratching our heads saying, gosh, we never realized we affected so many people. You know, when a crime is committed or hurt is done to somebody, it affects so many other people. You know, in a situation like this gentleman was in, you know, you have obviously the victim's family, and then the person who committed the crime or caused the hurt, their family is hurt by that too. You have police officers that have to come to the scene and investigate. You have crime scene investigators. You have paramedics, doctors, emergency ER people. Then in the courts, you have judges, attorneys, witnesses, lawyers. I mean, it just ripples out. So many people are affected. And with restorative justice, it's about trying to bring all stakeholders together when that is possible, and it's not always possible, but to do that, to try to heal that harm. This is not a new idea. It's an old concept. It's definitely a Jesus model. We have many scriptural examples of that, of Jesus. Oftentimes when he healed somebody that was sick or hurt, they were alienated from their community. Even women that were on their menstrual cycles at the time were alienated from their communities back then, like the hemorrhaging woman at the time. That's one good example where Jesus brought healed and brought them back to their community. It's an important part of those readings, I think, that sometimes we miss. God's justice and human justice are very different. So restorative justice goes back to biblical times. They use this kind of a process to help heal relationships that were broken, a sin that was caused, hurt that was caused. Indigenous tribes used it as well to brought the people together, all the people together that did the crime and were hurt by it and tried to reconcile. They didn't have prison systems back then where they could lock people away for life. So they found ways to do this. And it worked for the most part. It very much worked. But God's justice is always restorative. I guess it's no wonder that the word justice and righteousness meaning making things right again, is mentioned over 300 times in our scriptures. Our legal system today seeks punishment, and then they call it justice. And I'm not saying that we don't have to have jails, because some people just need to be locked up and be away from people because they're going to hurt them. Understand that. But restorative justice also holds people accountable. They do have to become accountable and come to terms with what they've done and make amends for it as best as they can. But in my experience, again, back to this theme, there's just been no greater power than love that I've seen transform people. Nothing else transforms, transcends, heals the human heart like that. And I understand that there's a paradox. We're called to love, but when we've been violated by the people that we're supposed to love, whether it's somebody close to us or not close to us, we're called to love all people. I know that's a real struggle inside. And that's one thing that our restorative justice process tries to help accompany people through and help bring them to that place of healing so that they don't have to walk around being incarcerated all the time. So a lot of times it's, what do we do with that pain and that paradox? You know, we hold it till it transforms us. It is a paradox, and we ask God and the Holy Spirit to always guide us during these times to do what's right and lead us into practices of restorative justice. And there's a reflection, I believe, after this slide that highlights that a little bit more. Thank you.
So let's hear Fred's words again and take them into our heart. Love and hurt are both human experiences. In faith, we are called first and foremost to love. But in situations of hurtful wrongdoing, a paradox emerges, an inner conflict or struggle of the heart, where both love and hurt are experienced at the same time. So what do we do with this paradox within one heart that both hurts and is called to love at the same time? Is it possible to simply hold both together until it transforms us? What do we ask of our God?
So let us practice asking for forgiveness from somebody you may have hurt. And think about someone who has hurt you. Practice forgiving them your forgiveness.
Loving God, we pray for victims of violence and their families, that they may experience our love and support and find comfort in your compassion and in the promise of eternal life. We also hold in prayer all the times that we have harmed others or experienced harm in any form. Amen. Grant us the courage to seek out restorative encounters, to bring about our vision of healing and unity, that we, your people, may no longer be divided by the hurt we cause one another in our brokenness. Help us practice forgiveness in the small things so that we may embody your spirit of a more restorative justice in the big things. Amen.
Changes everything, hands and faces, earth and sky. Love changes everything, how you live and how you die. Love can make the summer fly, or a night seem like a lifetime. Yes, love changes everything. Now I tremble at your name. Nothing in the world will ever be the same. Love changes everything. Days are longer, words mean more. Love changes everything. Pain is deeper than before. Love will turn your world around, and that world will last forever. Yes, love changes everything. Brings you glory, brings you shame. Nothing in the world will ever be the same. Off into the world we go, planning future.
Thank you for joining us today. We hope you've been moved into action by what you have witnessed. We thank Sister Kit Gray. We thank Fred Lapusa from the Diocese of Orange, Sister Barbara Jean, and Sister Monique for joining us on the public witness, giving witness to restorative justice. We ask that you join us again next Thursday. And on behalf of the Sisters of St. Joseph of Orange, we thank you.